Well, good evening everybody. I'm Martin Postle, I'm the Deputy Director of Grants and Publications here at the Paul Mellon Centre, and I'd like to wish you a very warm welcome this evening, especially to those for whom this might be their first visit. There might just be one or two. Before we get into the main event, I just have to give a pre-event safety notice, and this is important and it's mandatory. So I'm just going to simply read out what it says in front of me here. There are no fire drills scheduled for the duration of the event. If the fire alarm sounds, please leave your belongings behind and calmly begin to evacuate the building. The nearest fire exits are on the ground floor, either through the front doors of the centre, through either of the front doors, that's 16 or 15. 16, as you know, is the main one that you come in. And you assemble outside 28 Bedford Square. Okay, 28. Which is to the right, okay? So just so we all bear that in mind. Well, 2020 is a remarkable year for us at the centre as we celebrate our 50th anniversary. And if you're curious as to what's gone on over the past half century, you can find out more in this special, beautifully designed issue of PMC Notes, if you haven't seen it before, totally free of charge, and you can pick it up before you leave. It's called the Paul Mellon Centre, 1970 to 2020, A Brief History, and it was written by Mark Hallett, who's our centre's director, and it is a good read. Now, we mark our 50th anniversary with a series of special lectures, events and publications, and among the most prestigious events are the scheduled Wednesday evening seminars, which are led by prominent figures who have in various different ways made significant contributions to scholarship in British art and architecture. And tonight, on the occasion of the fourth of these seminars, I'm delighted to introduce the eminent architectural historian, Dr. Stephen Brindle. Stephen began his academic career at Keble College, Oxford, where he read modern history, and he studied subsequently for a doctoral thesis on late medieval architecture in Spain. Some scholars, quite understandably, are content to intensify their knowledge of their particular specialist area to the point where they gain universal respect for a particular expertise. Stephen, although he has such expertise in spades, has, through a long and distinguished career, extended the breadth of his knowledge to cover a wide and varied terrain. All the more remarkable since Stephen has had a rather demanding day job all his life, having worked for English Heritage since 1989 as an inspector of ancient monuments and presently a senior properties historian. Stephen's publications stretch back over some 30 years, going back to 1992, when he made significant contributions to the Blue Guide to the Country Houses of England, which I don't even know, it's a rather whacking volume, and Stephen wrote, I think, about 30% of the entries. In 1997, with Brian Carr, Windsor revealed New Light on the History of the Castle. Also, a number of very detailed articles, notably Pembroke House, Whitehall, which was for the Georgian Group, 1998. Stephen, of course, has written several major books, such as Paddington Station, Its History and Architecture, published in 2004, and that was the first full history of Paddington Station. And then, immediately afterwards, in 2005, the biography of Isambard Kingdom Brunel. Brunel, the man who built the world. For English Heritage, Stephen has produced a variety of publications, including Shot from Above, Aerial Aspects of London, Whitby Abbey, Wellington Arch, Chapter House and Pick's Chamber at Westminster Abbey, Dover Castle. Stephen also wrote several essays for the magisterial exhibition catalogue William Kent, Designing Georgian Britain, which was edited by Susan Webber, was the exhibition in 2013. More recently, he was editor and lead author for Windsor Castle, A Thousand Years of Royal Palace, and that was published in 2018. In spring of 2017, against stiff competition, and I do mean that, Stephen was awarded a senior fellowship by the Paul Mellon Centre to work on a general history, architecture in Britain and Ireland, 1530 to 1830, a successor to Sir John Summerson's canonical book, which was published in the Pelican History of Art series, first of all in 1953, and most of us have probably got a copy of some edition or another on our shelves. Stephen's book is to be published shortly by the Paul Mellon Centre. It's this book that forms, this book project, that forms the background to Stephen's talk this evening, Architectural History After Summerson. On that note, I'd like to welcome Stephen to the podium.
Thank Thank you very much, Martin. That's very kind. I've incurred an embarrassingly long and lengthening list of debts of gratitude in the course of my current project, ladies and gentlemen. But for this evening, I would just like to single out thanks Yale University Press, and in particular Sally Salveson, for initially commissioning me to write this book, the Paul Mellon Centre for adopting it as a project, and for giving me a senior research fellowship, without which I'm not really sure where I'd be, probably somewhere in the 1630s still, and Mark and Emily in particular for all their encouragement and moral support. I'm saying I've lots of other debts of gratitude, but I'm afraid I'll have to come around and thank them all in person at a later date, otherwise we'll be here all evening. Right. Now, there's a few questions to be going on with. Doesn't do just to take all these for granted, I think. So a few questions to carry at the back of your minds, and we might think about them again at the end. Why do we do all this? And to get the ball rolling, here is a case study from Dublin in the 1960s, which I think encapsulates some of these issues rather nicely. Back in the 1760s, Viscount Fitzwilliam of Merion was developing his estate to the south of the Liffey, and that included Merion Square and Fitzwilliam Square, and between them, Fitzwilliam Street. And Fitzwilliam Street had, until the events of which I'm about to speak, the longest continuous row of Georgian terrace houses in existence, the Georgian Mile, they called it, and people of Dublin were very proud of it. And they said and wrote things like this. The Irish Times, God bless them, said, "What would Canaletto have made of this view?" Good for the Irish Times. That's lovely. And Maurice Craig, who's a really wonderful writer, has this sort of wonderful poetic response to it. But, of course, because I'm telling you a story, of course something bad is going to happen, and is going to happen to these specific houses, numbers 13 to 28, which belonged to the Electricity Supply Board of Ireland, who rather unfortunately are going to be the villains of the piece here. They had their head office there, and around about 1962, they decided this was no longer fit for purpose, as they say, and they wanted to replace it with a new building. Now, you might think that at this date, Irish opinion in relation to this kind of architecture would range from indifference to hostility, but you would be quite mistaken. Whatever Irish people might think or have thought about country houses in relation to Dublin, well, they have long loved their city and felt very proud of it. And when the ESB's plans went public, people said things like this. The president of the Royal Irish Academy said, "Will the next move be to feed the books in the library of Trinity College, the boilers of the Pigeon House?" That's Dublin's main power station. The Manchester Guardian, God bless them, said, "Is there a public opinion in Ireland sufficiently concerned to put a stop to this vandalism? And if not, why not?" And the Dublin City Architect said, "How important is the Book of Kells?" And you see what else he wrote there. And there was an answer to the Manchester Guardian's question, because there was a public meeting at Dublin's Mansion House to oppose the ESB's plans, was ended by 900 people, that is, the 900 who could fit in, and another 300 left outside the door who didn't. So Dublin was fiercely opposed to this idea. And a battle started to rage. But the Electricity Supply Board, of course, a well-connected public body. The Earl of Pembroke, rather surprisingly, as heir to the Fitzwilliams, was the grand landlord of all this, and he offered the ESB an alternative site a couple of streets away, and they rejected his offer, and instead they served a compulsory purchase order on him, and they bought 16 of these houses for a derisory £1,000. And at this point, the Electricity Supply Board, against fierce and mounting public opposition, held a competition to find a design for a replacement. And it was won by a Dublin practice called Gibney Stevenson Associates. And it is fair to record that the Irish Institution of Architects were in support of redevelopment. At this point, the ESB called in Sir John Summerson, who had already expressed himself in favour of redevelopment, to give his opinion. And this is what he wrote. "It has no special architectural coherence. It is not a planned facade, nor an architectural entity. It is simply one damned house after another. This does not constitute architectural unity. It does not even constitute uniformity, for the houses are a sloppy, uneven series. I do see that for the sake of uniformity of character over a wide area, there was some real point in considering preservation, but on balance, it seemed to me wrong. It is nearly always wrong to preserve rubbish, and by Georgian standards, these houses are rubbish. Now, just think for a moment where such a judgment would leave most English high streets. And let's move on. Simply one damned house after another. So, as you see, down they came, and that's what replaced them. I make no judgment. I leave you to form their own. The battle raged another 2 years. The Irish Georgian Society and the Old Dublin Society organised meetings and petitions. And in September 1964, the day before a new planning act came into force, which would have saved the houses, the Minister for Local Government signed an order granting planning permission for demolition. And the 16 houses were demolished in the summer of 1965. So there they are, and there's what replaced them, and you won't be entirely surprised to know that their replacement is now obsolete and scheduled to be demolished. And you also won't be surprised to know that the Irish have never forgotten all this. Here are two recent posts where you read Dublin block that ruined the Georgian mile and branded as an act of vandalism. And Sir John Summerson's reputation in Ireland has understandably never recovered from this episode and certain other slights which we may consider. But in England, I think relatively few people know about all this. Could I have a show of hands for those of you who knew this story? A good few. Well, you are a very well-informed audience, after all, but even so, it's only a good few. And it can still seem surprising to an English audience that this judgment should have come from the author of Georgian London. Well, he is a very, very considerable man indeed, and you might say that he's one of our Holy Trinity or of our three knights, the three great knighted architectural historians who dominated the subject from the 1940s to the 1990s. And the remarkable thing about them is how one can, in a loose kind of way, characterise their contributions to our subjects, starting with Howard, who's the only one who I knew personally, and the astonishing achievement of his biographical dictionary. Howard, of course, like all three of these figures, had a very broad range. Those of you who are medievalists will know that The White Canons in England is still by far the best book on the subject, but what he's famous for is the great biographical dictionary. It is true that the biographical approach to architecture, putting architects in the foreground, arguably distorts the picture, is arguably subject to criticism. And a good many such criticisms were made at the conference held about Howard and his legacy and in the volume which was published after. And I have to say, I was a little shocked by some of the criticisms which I thought unjust as applied to Howard. Because this is an astonishing achievement, and I would suggest that this is the only book in our subject which really is indispensable and will remain so for the indefinite future. So, a great man and a great historian, to my mind. And then we come to, I think, perhaps the greatest of them all, this great and admirable German scholar whose work had such remarkable range and who, probably more than any other individual, taught British people to value their architecture in a more systematic way, to understand it in a European context, but also to value it at a local level and understand the relationship between what they had locally and what we possess as an inheritance nationally. The breadth of his achievement is astonishing. The Buildings of England and the companion volumes to the other nations, an achievement as remarkable as Colvin's dictionary and as expressive of intense personal commitment and effort. Pevensey's achievement, of course, was not capable, as Howard's astonishingly was, of being brought to something like fullness in one lifetime. He himself said, with characteristic generosity, that the revised editions would be the really valuable ones, and what gold mines they are turning out to be under Yale and Paul Mellon Center's benevolent hands and under Simon Charles's superb editorship. And Pevensey, of course, as the the true Renaissance man of art and architectural history in Britain in the 20th century, also gave us the Pelican History of Art, and one of the first authors he commissioned in 1947 was the third of our three knights, Sir John Summerson. Now, quite a lot of what I'm going to say this evening will be, on the whole, critical, as I think you'd probably be disappointed if it wasn't, and it would be a slightly feeble-sounding lecture if it wasn't. So I would like to say at the outset, and I'll probably read at the end, that I think Summerson was indeed, was by any standards, a great historian and one of the great makers of our subject. But of the three, he is certainly the most enigmatic and the most contradictory, and his legacy has been the most contested. And we'll think about some of the reasons for that in due course. Now, if Colvin's great achievement was to provide an extraordinarily comprehensive base of knowledge of architects, was biographical, and if Pevener's greatest achievement, greatest of his many, was topographical, a topographical approach, the cataloguing of buildings by place and understanding them in their context, what then is Summerson's USP? Well, it has to be the narrative of architectural style, embodied above all in his great book, Architecture in Britain, written in 6 years, 1947 to 53, his most important work. The book embodies an architect-dominated, aesthetically driven view of architecture, which to a large extent does seem to have been shared by the other two, by Colvin and Pevsner. And Summerson's book is the definitive statement of this view, and long remained so. It was in print for over 50 years until well after his death in 1992, I think almost to the end of the century. And in it, Summerson created the narrative of English architectural history based on the evolution of architectural styles, and he helped create a canon of the great works through which the story has customarily been told ever since. Like both of the other knights, Summerson had a broad range. His thought, the range of his work, extending much further than this, and indeed at first he did not seem destined to be a historian at all. He abandoned a place at Cambridge to attend the Bartlett School of Architecture and graduated from it, and he had periods of pupillage with a number of practices, but they did not lead to a career, and in some ways I think he remained an architect manqué. In the 1930s, after this uncertain start, he became an architectural journalist and writer, committed to the modernist agenda, and the chance discovery on a stall of a bundle of drawings by Nash and Repton launched him on his career as a historian, culminating in his first book, his superb biography of John Nash, in 1935. And during the war, further good fortune led him to a place in the newly created National Buildings Record regarding war-threatened buildings in London, and the beginnings of a fruitful career as a broadcaster for the BBC, and a further, even greater stroke of luck in 1945 when he was appointed curator of Sir John Soane's Museum in succession to Arthur Bolton. Summerson's achievement at Sir John Soane's Museum alone was a remarkable one and would probably have merited a knighthood. As Margaret Richardson has pointed out, it was to turn what had been an almost insolvent charity running what amounted to a private house with very limited access into a much-loved, well-organised national museum with trustees, exhibitions and its superb library, a centre for the study of classical architecture. And all this was very largely Sir John's achievement. And these post-war years also saw the publication of Georgian London in 1945, a reaction to his experience, National Buildings Record, one of the great works of urban history of the 20th century. But Summerson in the early 1950s had a marked shift in his career. He withdrew from journalism and engagement with contemporary architecture, and he never commented on this decision or made any kind of explanation of it. There does seem to be a turning point in his career and his attitudes between about 1945 and 1955. Peter Mandler, writing in a collection of essays after the Victorians, sees Summerson as a disappointed figure, disappointed with the way that modernism and urbanism moved in the 1950s towards corporate and political control, and disappointed with the brutalist values, and that he retreated into architectural history and from active engagement with contemporary architecture as a result in the mid-50s. Alan Powers, writing in 2000, noted the difficulty of reconstructing Summerson's attitudes to modernism, noting that to do so you have to read lots of articles scattered in different places which all seem to say different things, noting Summerson's critical mindset and his undefined ideals that shifted constantly and the degree to which he was apparently temperamentally averse to satisfaction with anything. And I think this is part of the problem. For despite his undoubted status as a member of the establishment, there was always an oppositional quality to Summerson and his writing. And this was reflected in his last great public statement about modernism and contemporary architecture, his RIBA lecture of 1957, The Case for a Theory of Modern Architecture. Summerson seemed not to believe that such a thing was possible. And to say something like that in 1957 did not go down well with the profession. Summerson declined to explain himself further, and that was about his last public statement on contemporary architecture until the Mansion House Square affair of the mid-1980s. You might say it has been suggested that his 30s left-wing conscience turned against the way modernism was developing in the brutalist generation, or to use Sir Hugh Casson's terms, he was a herbivore in the age of the carnivores, and he withdrew into history. Greatly lauded at the time, a public figure on almost every major public body in the area, but Summerson remains in many ways an enigmatic figure, and the most enigmatic of the three knights. He began intending to be an architect. He became an architectural journalist and writer. He became by degrees a historian and withdrew into architectural history. And there was a sense that his powerful, sceptical, critical intelligence, dissatisfied with the way modernism was turning out, instead of being turned on what dissatisfied him in contemporary architecture, was turned on subjects in architectural history instead. In other words, he turned his faculties as an architectural critic onto historical subjects, something I'll be talking more about. So, of our three knighted historians, Colvin, Pevsner and Summerson, embodying architects, topography, style, three different ways of understanding architectural history, three powerfully normative ways of organising the subject, referring to and reinforcing each other. However, as several historians have pointed out more recently, the apparent authority there is open to question. This approach translates into architectural history as a story about individual architects and a sequence of canonical great works. It freezes the narrative into a set form. It sidelines the Gothic, the provincial, and the vernacular. And it tends to leave out all the other people involved, the craftsmen who made the buildings and the people who commissioned, paid for, and then used them. This approach, in a word, leaves out society. And so, although there is a natural authority to the three knights, architects, places, style, there are obvious grounds on which to criticise, and actually for a long time, other historians have been providing us with very distinguished works showing how far architecture and architectural history can be written from other points of view. I'll just run through a few to remind you of the range, because I'm sure you all know these things very well, and that's the point, that they're well known. Like David Watkins' superb biographically based study of Thomas Hope, like Mark Girouard's magnificent Life in the English Country House, which advanced our understanding of this vast subject and theme in a quite new and different way. And I think Mark Girouard's book in particular, one of the most influential books there's been on our subject since the Second World War. And then there are books which deal with craftsmen and craft skills, which turn from the architects to the craftsmen who actually made and built things, like these superb volumes, which really strike a blow for materiality and against the occasional tendency to become fixated on design. And there are other scholars who have concentrated on material categories, on the materiality of buildings in different ways, like Geoffrey Beard on plasterwork, Ron Bogsill on brick. And since the 1980s, the country house studies and the understanding of historic interiors have added a whole further dimension to architectural history and started to make links between architectural history and the fine arts and the decorative arts and wider culture, wider visual culture, in a way which Colvin and Pevsner and Summerson generally did not. So for a long time now, other very distinguished historians have been proposing different ways of looking at this subject. And these are this new and altogether welcome focus on society and the materiality and uses of the buildings brings us to yet another and quite different way of understanding architecture, which actually goes back at least 100 years further. And this, of course, is the existing antiquarian and archaeological tradition. For when the three knights started work in the 1930s, they were working in a European-inspired tradition of art history, but the native tradition, native to this country, you might say, was quite different in character, having originated with the Society of Antiquaries in the 18th century and having a much more archaeological character and a focus that was overwhelmingly on the Middle Ages until the 20th century, I think. And this antiquarian archaeological culture produced work of superb quality at a very early date, as we see, I think, in J.C. Buckler's survey of the lost Romanesque tower of Canterbury Cathedral, that's from about 1823, or Sir Harold Breakspear's phased plan of Winchester Cathedral here. And if you pick up any volume of the Victoria County History, you will find that it refers to Georgian country houses, for example, as a modern mansion in the classical style of no historical interest. But where the church is concerned, you'll find something like this. You'll find a phase plan with a precise antiquarian analysis of how that building developed over time. There is, of course, not a single phase plan in Summerson's Architecture in Britain. And this kind of antiquarian archaeological understanding, rather like those books about brick and plasterwork and country house furnishings, strikes a blow for materiality, but in a rather different way. It provides an alternative way of reading architecture to the slight obsession with the architect's control through design, the idea that architecture is really all about the design, is about black lines on a white page. The antiquarian, the archaeological view, starts from the surviving fabric and works backwards towards design, and it gives us very different insights. And insights into historic buildings are something which change and evolve over time. This is something which Colvin, by the nature of his subject matter, very rarely had to engage with. Pevsner often had to engage with it because of the nature of his subject matter. Summerson, I think, chose not to, but more of that later. And this alternative tradition, the archaeological or antiquarian tradition, isn't something that's confined to old volumes of the VCH. It's something that evolves and continues. Although to a puzzling degree, it seems to have evolved as a separate culture to the kind of modern architectural history, which I think most of us are probably more aware of. There's a slightly perplexing division between the archaeological side of historic buildings culture and modern architectural history. But the archaeological strand of historic buildings culture gives us remarkable insights like this, for example. This is an analytical elevation of the White Tower, the Tower of London, showing, confirming for the first time that it really was built in two phases, one in the reign of William the Conqueror and one in the reign of William Rufus. This is from mortar analysis, and the mortar analysis also confirms the dates of various major campaigns of refacing. And here are two projects which I've been involved with. This is a survey of the great kitchen roof at Windsor, at first thought to be entirely 19th century, and then found to be medieval, and then found by dendrochronology to be a 15th century rebuilding of a 14th century roof with a major phase of 16th century repair and with decorative casing added by Sir Geoffrey Whiteville in the 1820s. And here is another rather nice example of a building being repurposed over time at the very grandest scale. And this is a long survey for the St George's Hall range of Windsor Castle, and this shows you how a very grand building was reimagined at three stages. First, as an 18-bay range, you see the 18 bays in the vault below, and then reworked to an 11-bay rhythm by Hugh May in the 1680s for Charles II, and you see how May has carved out new openings to alter the ground floor to his new 11-bay rhythm, and then reworked to the Gothic style by Wyatt Fill in the 1820s. And archaeological excavation, especially development excavation under PBG Planning Policy Guidance Paper 16, has enormously enhanced our understanding of the development of medieval and early modern towns through archaeological work like this. This is an excavation of the City of London, revealing the foundations of a 12th century stone house, of a kind of which there seemed to be an surprising number in the 12th century City of London. This from that wonderful book, John Scofield's Medieval London Houses. And so great quantities of new data and new information now repose in archaeological archives about the early history of towns, and wonders how many modern architectural historians are really entirely aware of this. And it's a little perplexing to me that there's still such a wide gap between these different strands of historical culture, but so it is. I return now to our three knights' master narratives, architect, topography, and style. So, of course, they were never the whole picture. And these three, architect, topography, style, are manifestly not all of a piece. They are not entirely comparable to each other. The biographical and topographical themes, architect and place, have an independent reality. The architects and the places would still exist, would have historical reality outside any discussion of architecture. They have an independent reality to them, and one can hardly, but one can't quite make the same claim for style. And what about Summerson's great book? It has been so central to our subject that again and again, writers since Summerson have cited his judgments, have formulated their arguments and views in relation to his. The book has arguably had to bear an unfair degree of scrutiny. And we have to consider how well this approach has weathered the concentration on architectural style. I suppose the first general criticism would be that style is now widely felt to be a problematic concept in a way that Summerson never acknowledged. The great labels, Gothic, Baroque, Neoclassical, Rococo and Palladian, were for the most part unknown to society at the time. They are more recent coinings. And a second general criticism of the style-led art historical approach is that it is ahistorical. It does not take account of broader themes in social, economic and cultural history, and the resulting narrative exists in a kind of vacuum. So the first example of this, encountered in architecture in Britain, is the way that Summerson introduces English medieval architecture, English Gothic architecture, in the early 16th century. And this is what he says about it. This extreme taste for the flat, the square, the shallow, which had been defining itself ever more clearly for over a century, represents the final withdrawal from the poetry of Gothic. Is a negative taste, an eliminating taste. It stylizes the past, reduces it to compact symbols, and dismisses it. It is the taste of the end of an epoch, but it is also a taste peculiarly receptive to novelty. As the Gothic spirit is withdrawn, it leaves a void extremely attractive to alien ideas. Now, I feel at the same time that this is a superbly well-written passage, but I disagree with every word. As a medievalist, I find this deeply objectionable, and that Summerson considers this an appropriate way of introducing the subject of English art in the 16th century and the relationship between it and its medieval legacy astonishes me. I mean, if you think of all the ways in which you might introduce medieval building culture and its legacies to the early modern age. You might talk about the division of building between the 90% of buildings that were timber and the 10% which were in stone. You might talk about the shape of households and the shape of houses. You might talk about the corporate collegiate quality of late medieval culture, especially in towns, which would have an obvious relevance to buildings like these. You might think about the origins of English perpendicular Gothic and its building culture, about the masons in their lodges. You might think about the degree to which Gothic architecture had developed in relation to religious building and patronage, that is, almost entirely. This kind of architecture, religious architecture, had been almost solely, entirely responsible for stylish development ever since the English began building in stone in the 7th century. You might think about the degree to which the fine arts, sculpture, painting, stained glass, art, metalwork and textiles had all developed in relation to church buildings and church architecture and the way in which medieval society thought about the fine arts, architecture and all of these other things together. And you might go on to observe what sort of effect the Reformation had on this coherent culture of patronage, the degree to which this cultural catastrophe ended the culture, ended religious patronage, and was accompanied by waves of destruction. So there were lots of things which you could say to provide a historical grounding here, but Summerson doesn't mention any of them. He completely disregards the Reformation and its dramatic consequences for the architecture and the new arts. And as you see, he elides the end of the Gothic tradition in church building with the idea that the style itself was in decline, heading into an aesthetic vacuum. Well, I put these buildings up just to show you exactly what kind of aesthetic vacuum it was, and why I hope these will hint at why I disagree with him so profoundly here. To any medievalist, this approach is not just anomalous, it is astonishing. It is completely ahistorical, and the resulting judgments are downright misleading. And it exemplifies further, in the most regrettable way, the degree to which the scholarly community remains divided between medievalists who look at this kind of thing and modern historians who really pick up about the point that Summerson starts. There is a gulf here which urgently needs bridging, and Summerson has done really nothing to help. Now, I'm not going to talk about this subject because Giles did it so much better than I possibly could, so I'm merely going to refer to his book. Summerson's interpretation of Palladianism as a distinctive insular kind of English classical architecture again has been questioned at several points and several people and subjected to a thorough revisionist approach by Giles Worsley in his Classical Architecture in Britain, The Heroic Age. But one can make the general point that Giles here operates and comments broadly within Summerson's own terms, within concepts of architectural style, and leaving aside most of the other considerations, client, craftsman, materiality, which one might think about. So while this is very much a revision of Summerson, it is a book in the Summersonian tradition. What I would like to talk about for a while now is this concept, artisan mannerism, Summerson's own coining. Summerson coined the term, as we know, to describe a strand of English architecture that he identified in 1620s and 30s, the classical architecture that wasn't correct, that wasn't by Jones and Webb, that wasn't connected with the court. And he describes it again in primarily visual, stylistic terms as follows. The style, the natural successor to the Jacobean, has never been given a name. Artisan mannerism may perhaps serve, for the style is essentially that of the best London craftsmen, joiners, carpenters, masons and bricklayers. It is not hard to recognise. In feeling, it is broad and coarse and has none of naïf intensity or exciting contrast to the preceding style, nor the fine taste and exquisite balance of Jones. So this is a visual reaction of a visually very sensitive aesthete. Now, Summerson's approach has already been criticised here. Historians like Lucy Gent and Caroline Van Eck have pointed out the distortions which arise from seeing Jonesian classical architecture as correct and normative and anything which departs from it as provincial and uncouth. I strongly agree with these revisionist views, and I don't feel the need to rehearse them in detail. But I would like to propose an alternative approach. And I think that Summerson, in identifying artisan mannerism as a style, is actually conflating the symptoms of more fundamental changes in the culture of building and the way houses were conceived that were unfolding in England right to the 17th century, and construing these selected symptoms into an artistic style, which I don't think has any real existence other than in 20th century historians' minds. And we might list these fundamental changes as follows. First, social change and change in the shape of houses. Decline in the hall as a common space. Servants beginning to be consigned to service quarters in basements and attics. An increased wish for privacy, an increase in number of private chambers in houses, and the rise of the compact double-pile house as a response to social change and a change in the shape of households, which might be either traditional or formal in its architectural presentation. As you hear, this is Clegg Hall in Lancashire about 1610 and Cheveney in Kent, convincingly attributed to and or gone to Jones of about 1625. And here are two more examples, Boston Manor in London and Coles Hill. And what these tell us, obviously, is that the double pile house isn't necessarily an architecturally formal thing. It comes in both in more informal vernacular styles and in more formally conceived shapes like Coles Hill. And then the next great theme is the decline of timber framing, which had, remember, been absolutely ubiquitous in the 16th century, and it has almost died out as something, as an externally expressed thing by the end of the 17th century, and its replacement by brickwork. But I think there is a further point here, which is quite often missed, that most brick construction in the 15th and 16th century was mass brickwork, like the Dutch house at Kew on the left, with thick brick walls, which in construction are essentially similar to stone masonry. The brick simply takes place of stone, and the walls are nice and thick. And the new kind of brick construction, which rises in the 17th century, is a thin-walled style, exemplified by these famous houses in Stoke Newington, and there must have been a great many more of them. And this, of course, is historically of huge significance because it's the origin of London Terrace House. And in those houses in Stoke Newington, because they still have their gables end onto the street, you can sense the way in which the timber frame townhouse is morphing into the later brick terrace house. And as we know, a great many of these terrace houses, thin-walled houses, are reliant on structural timber. And in many cases, it seems clear that carpenters remained in control of the process. And as we know, right through the 18th century, a great many of the terrace houses in London were really built by, managed by carpenters, who people have called themselves carpenters rather than bricklayers. So there is a spread of brick construction which is of particular significance, not simply because it's a continuation of this thick-walled style, which you can trace way back to the 14th century, but almost more significant, there's the rise of this new thin-walled style of construction, which is going to provide the new vernacular for town architecture. And it must have been well-developed and well-understood by the mid-17th century, if you think about it, for Wren and Hook to be able to set those conditions in the 1667 Act after the Great Fire of London. You don't set conditions for a whole class of building that are as clear and specific and actually as effective as that if there isn't already a well-understood body of practice for Wren and Hook to refer to and call on. So it's not something which is, I think, historically very well understood, partly because very few of the early 17th century examples survive, but it's clearly immensely important. And then there's the matter of window design, which has a special place in English culture in the Middle Ages and right up to the late 17th century. And this comes back to fairly fundamental issues, doesn't it? London has 4 hours of direct sunlight a day, and Manchester has about 3, whereas Rome has 6.5. And northern light diffused through clouds is a rather different matter to bright Mediterranean sunlight. And so the English, whenever they could afford to, wanted to let light in. And traceried windows became one of the most important themes in English Gothic architecture, and the largest traceried windows ever created are in this country. And traceried windows were one of the central driving factors behind all perpendicular architecture, and in the 16th century, that tradition of window design became translated into window design in the great Elizabethan houses. And there are all sorts of obvious points you can make about status and display and the use of glass, but there are also, but these were also wonderful design statements. And statements of great sophistication, and it's entirely a native tradition which doesn't really owe anything to any other country. And so its change and disappearance in the 17th century is in some ways rather perplexing. You could say that window design experiences its phase of maximum variety in the 1620s and 30s in a house like Swakeley's here, which, as you see, has windows of new style, upright and square and oval, but it also has old-style mullion transom windows and bay windows, and there's Bolsover Castle, where the new kind of upright windows are being interpreted with old-style stone mullions and transoms still. And the curious point here is that the period of maximum variety is actually also the period of Inigo Jones's surveyorship, and we know that Jones was trying through royal proclamations to enforce the use of upright windows in London, so what does that tell you about the nature of Jones's influence at the time? But nevertheless, this culture resolves itself down by late century to just two forms, and this native tradition of elaborate and showy and inventive window design more or less disappears in a generation. Why is this? Well, obviously, upright windows allow a facade to be designed in accordance with the principles of classical architecture, but is that really the only consideration? When you consider who the clients for a building like, for instance, the building on the right here were, would they really have been thinking about Andrea Palladio in thinking about the shape of their windows? I somehow doubt it. And this is something of a puzzle, and I have never seen a scholar really grappling with this in print. Henty Lowe obviously has done wonderful research about sash windows, but that's a later and separate subject. So I just comment on the nature of some of these issues, and some of them actually look rather strange when you start looking at them by themselves. The relationship between walls and roofs is another. Of course, in medieval and 16th century building culture, most buildings are essentially formed of ranges one room deep, between 15 and 25 feet deep, covered with a roof at a pitch of between 40 and 60 degrees, and more elaborate building shapes are made by putting ranges one room deep together and having short sort of return ranges and bay windows and things. And roofs like this end in gables, and so Elizabethan houses, you make the composition out of the gables, and from the 1590s, the gable itself, so far from going into a decline, goes into a period of manic elaboration and experiment, which lasts again until the 1630s. And as with window design, the period of greatest variety, greatest experiment, greatest eclecticism is also the period of Inigo Jones's dominance as surveyor, when he is supposed to be spreading correct classical architecture. Of course, we actually know that Jones is a more complex figure than that, and Jones himself designed what are called Holborn gables, looking a little like the ones on Swakeley's for a house for Sir Fulk Greville. So all of these things, of course, are more complicated than we really understand. And the culture of the gable, after reaching its great elaboration then, as like the elaborate window design, disappears completely in one generation. So what's going on? And as double pile plans take over, so the gables disappear from English architecture, and that whole kind of design language disappears. And towards the end of the 17th century, there is this very strong sense of a closing down of options, a closing down of variety, as English architecture converges on fewer and simpler forms. And you can present this, of course, as being the rise of classicism, because these forms are generally more compatible with principles of classical design. But is that how people in the real world really design buildings? I rather doubt it. They design buildings in terms of fundamental issues. And here's the fifth and last one. And this is the change in heating method, the rise in coal as a fuel. There's a huge submerged issue here, which I think architectural historians need to think about a little more. England had a timber famine in the 17th century, and that's one of the reasons why brick takes over from timber framing, and it's also one of the reasons why coal takes over from wood as the main domestic fuel source, especially in towns. And this makes a huge difference to architecture, because coal emits toxic fumes, which a wood fire does not, and it thus demands a much better, much more efficient stack, which will be guaranteed to take all the smoke out of the house. But coal also has twice as much stored calorific value by mass as wood, which means that it's more compact, that it takes up less storage space, and you get more heat out of a smaller fire. And that means that as long as you can afford the coal, you can have more and smaller fireplaces, but the result is that they now have to share a stack, and you need to build stacks out of brick in order to serve several flues at once. And the result, architecturally, is that flues migrate from outer walls to inner walls, and from being big and generally serving just one fireplace per floor, they migrate to spine walls, where they will probably serve a lot more chimneys and become quite complex constructions. And so here, Ham House rather nicely illustrates both generations. Sir Thomas Vavasour's original house of 1610 was an H-plan. It was just one room deep, so it embodies the medieval tradition, Tudor tradition, in that kind of way. And as you see, it had big stacks on its external walls. William Samwell filled in one side of the H for the Duke and Duchess of Lauderdale, made it very fashionable indeed. It had some of the first sash windows in England. And as you see, he turned the centre of the house into what is, to all intents and purposes, a double-pile house, although I think it has an M roof with a valley gutter, and he concentrated his stacks on the spine wall. And so we have a number of really fundamental changes in building culture unfolding across the course of the 17th century. At the beginning of the century, James I implicitly believed in witchcraft. His grandson, Charles II, believed in mathematics and astronomy and founded the Royal Society. And by the end of the century, we can see incipient modernity, I think, in things like the double-pile house, the servants pushed into the basement, the terrace house, the end of that grand tradition of window design, the sense that fewer and simpler design motifs are being used everywhere, a wider use of glass, but just in two different window styles. We see incipient modernity, and there is loss here as well as gain. There is the loss of the entire native timber construction tradition. There's the loss of that great tradition of window design. There's the loss of the tradition of gable design. There's the loss of most of the medieval inheritance, to the point that by the end of the century, Gothic is a matter of conscious revival. But Sir John doesn't really discuss any of these underlying factors, and he, as we noted a little earlier, sees artisan mannerism in terms of his aesthetic response to it one building at a time. He's selected a group of houses from the mid-17th century which exhibit various of these features, and he's coined this label to understand them in his own stylistic terms. And the implication is that the building's appearance was mainly determined by aesthetic decisions taken by the artisans in question, that these buildings represent design or disegno in the same kind of way as a building by Inigo Jones, only in his view, the artisans just aren't very good at it. Whereas I would suggest that a more historically informed view would suggest that no one setting out to build a house in the 17th century or any other century does so with a primarily or solely aesthetic agenda in mind. Other economic, social and technical factors are usually uppermost in their minds, and these buildings should be understood in a quite different way, as if they were vernacular architecture, and that their appearance is generated not by a design intention on the part of the craftsman, but by these fundamental questions, these issues like lighting and heating and plan form, and that the decorative finishes derived from paper sources, which Sir John set so much store by in identifying this as a style, are literally superficial, added at the end. I say that the important story here is how the vernacular language of English architecture changed radically over the course of the 17th century, and by the end of the century we have a design language which has been created by craftsmen, not architects, which we can recognise as modern. So I'm sorry, Sir John, I just don't buy artisan mannerism. I think it's a construction and one that is ripe for deconstruction. And worse, I think it obstructs and obscures judgment by distracting attention from these underlying historical causes, which have indeed received surprisingly little attention from scholars. The Achilles heel of a style-based approach to architectural history is its tendency to mistake symptoms for causes. Now, Summerson, as I've suggested, brought the mind of an architectural critic, and a very sharp and distinguished one, to architectural history. And much of his writing, especially architecture in Britain, is marked by a tendency to summarise buildings, places or architects with an aesthetic judgment, and often a negative one. Many of his judgments are very acute, but there is something troubling about this whole tendency. So let's look at a few examples. This is Wren's first building, Pembroke College Chapel, and what Sir John says is this. The ultimate appraisal of the building must be this. Must, note, it is constructed with a great deal of thought and expressed in sound Latin, but in conception it is unimaginative. Unpoetical, perhaps more exact, it implies the absence of that deft, intuitive coordination of thought and imagination, which is exactly what is missing in Pembroke Chapel. Sorry, Sir Christopher. Bad luck, Pembroke. This is from that famous essay, The Mind of Wren. I find this troubling, I don't know about you. The de haut en bas tone, the lack of any sense of doubt in his own judgment, the lack of any sense that this is a discussion, and the suspicion that Summerson actually expected his readers just to accept his judgments as true statements. And I think, again, a more historically based assessment of this might suggest a rather different answer. On the right is a plate from Serlio, which Summerson suggests may have been Wren's source, and I think he may well be right, but look what Sir Christopher has done with it. Now, bear in mind that in 1664, Wren has never built a building. He's no real experience of building. He's never left England. He may have had access to a copy of Serlio and Palladio, but that would have been about it. And this is the first building he's ever designed. And yet, look what he's done with this plate from Serlio. Look how he's turned the middle opening into an arched opening. Look at the proportional relationship between the arched openings. Look at the way he's placed that feature below the middle arch, which you could read symbolically as an altar, as a pedestal. And look at the beautiful, very slight recessions in the facade. And the way in which Wren the astronomer has modelled his facade, because he knows the shadows on it will change in the course of the day. Look at the way he's added modillions, presumably for this reason. Now, we see similar modellings of the wall surface done in a rather more spectacular way by Nicholas Hawksmoor in the 1710s in his wonderful churches. And we all say how wonderful it is, quite rightly. But at that date, Hawksmoor had the benefit of working for Wren for 30 years. Wren, when he built this, had never built a building, had no teacher, had at most had two or three architectural books, maybe, to work from. I don't know if he had access to Jones and Webb's drawings. I've no reason to believe he did. As models, he had the handful of executed works by Jones and Webb, and I would point out that none of them have quite this language, these slight recessions in the facade making shadow lines. It's something which Wren has developed for himself on the basis of that plate from Serlio. So how is that unpoetical? How does this not represent intuitive coordination of thought and imagination? Now, the fact is, I think Summerson's saying this because he has a line to take about Wren, which is that Wren is a scientist who never quite managed to make the transition to artist. And so, obviously, Pembroke Chapel has to fail this test because Wren has to fail to become an artist because that's the line Summerson's going to take. And this seems to me to be all wrong and very unfair. And I think if any of us designed that as our first ever building, we'd feel jolly proud of it. And I think it has perfect imagination. So let's move on to something rather more obvious, really. And that's Summerson on the subject of William Adam, who I think is an absolutely terrific architect, actually, I have to say. But Sir John, as you see, is marking him down and also saying that it's all based on English examples anyway. Most of his houses reflected the mixed influence of Wren, the Palladians, and Gibbs, and Adam showed no desire to discriminate between them. In a general way, he adopted Palladian plan arrangements, etc., etc. Well, I don't know. The objections to this rather careless summary now seem rather obvious. The assumption that Adam can be judged simply as a provincial extension of English architecture rather than a figure in a distinctive Scottish line of development from William Bruce and James Smith just seems obviously wrong. Note the assumption that the Anglo-Palladian style school is something superior and normative, and the corollary, the rather careless dismissal of Adam's richly decorative architecture in its quaintly barbaric richness. I think the quaintly is especially treacherous. And Summerson's assessment about Palladian plan arrangements is also quite wrong. As Ian Gow has shown, Adam's plans are often asymmetrical, determined by function rather than ideology, and respond in a rather sophisticated way to his client's needs. And it's not surprising that Scottish writers have reacted rather strongly against Sir John's rather cavalier treatment of their architectural history. And this kind of dismissal has related to Irish architecture as well. This building obviously has a very special place in Irish architectural history, and of it, Sir John wrote, the participation sub rosa of the Burlington group in Irish architecture extends to the mansion which Speaker Connolly built for himself at Castletown, etc., etc., etc. It has a three-story, 13-window front of stupendous monotony, while the planning includes a hall manifestly based on part of Inigo Jones's Whitehall designs, on the publication of which Kent will have been working on when Castletown was designed. Now, in this case, Summerson was actually obliged to revise in later volumes because Irish scholars, in particular Edward McParlan, have shown that all this is quite wrong and that Castletown was actually designed by an Italian architect, need a papal architect, no less, Alessandro Galilei, and a very brilliant Irishman who had studied in Italy, Edward Lovett Pierce. So Summerson's rather careless judgment has short-circuited all the other ways in which we might read Castletown. It isn't an English design at all. It was designed by an Italian and an Irishman. Contrary to Summerson's assumption of Burlingtonian influence, they had nothing to do with it. And it is nothing like contemporary English houses of either the Baroque or the Palladian generations. It was conceived by Speaker Connolly as a deliberate advertisement of Irish wealth and political self-confidence, like the contemporary Parliament House, and there is some reason to believe that Connolly deliberately conceived it as a non-English, even anti-English statement, and that it responds to Irish, not English, architectural preferences, which you also see in buildings like this. So Summerson's imposition of an Anglo-centric view and a style-led view has completely shortcut, short-circuited and undercut more sophisticated and probably more nearly correct readings of this remarkable building. And Irish historians like Eddie McParland and Christine Casey have, in entirely revising all this, have put Castletown in something more like its proper place in Irish and European cultural history. And last of these cases, we come to Edinburgh Newtown. Now, you might have thought that Edinburgh Newtown's really quite good, a World Heritage Site and all that, but Sir John would, I'm sorry to say, not have shared your view. He says this, he doesn't in fact have very much to say about it. He says, the new town expanded in four distinct areas, each planned in a formal manner, though with due appreciation of the discoveries of the woods of Bath and of what Nash was doing at Regent's Park. The architecture is generally a dour Grecian with little imaginative enterprise. I mean, even in Sir John's terms, this seems wide of the mark. It doesn't really look Greek to me. I'd say this was more like a testimony to the amazing longevity of the Palladian tradition. I mean, and this is really a sort of recapitulation of Robert Adam at Fitzroy Square and Charlotte Square, I would have said. But it gets worse. It gets worse. Royal Terrace. For sheer sullen gloom... This is probably the longest Georgian terrace in England. Well, I mean, I know length isn't everything, but, you know, it's impressive. For sheer sullen gloom, this is surpassed by St. Bernard's Crescent here. Inset Greek Gothic colonnades give an extraordinary impression. The building is some sort of residential mausoleum. Well, I mean, I suppose I've chosen the most mausoleum-like picture to give you a flavour of where Sir John's coming from here, but I doubt if that's quite how the good people of Edinburgh see it, really. And bear in mind that Edinburgh New Town is rightly a World Heritage Site, and that all of this is generally taken to be the architectural representation of the Scottish Enlightenment and all that. So, there you go. Are these really sufficient and appropriate judgments for the Pelican history of art? Well, I don't know, but Sir John clearly thought so. So, he's been throwing judgments around, and so I'm going to join in, I think. Are these aesthetic judgments true? Well, obviously not. They're expressions of personal taste. Do such statements have any historical value? How could they possibly? They take no account of the aesthetic preferences of the people who created these buildings, who may be presumed to have liked them rather better than Sir John. What use are such statements, and why publish them at all? Now, I'm not proposing any kind of censorship here. I'm not at all a woke person. I rather dislike that attitude, and I firmly believe in freedom of speech. But if Sir John is free to write such statements, then I am also free to react accordingly. And I say that these judgments are not presented as points for discussion, that they would not inspire anyone to look again or to value these buildings, that they are more likely to close down consideration than to encourage it, and worse, they mock those who live in these places, who love these buildings and feel pride in them, maintain and look after them. And in relation to other buildings, less securely placed than Edinburgh and Newtown, judgments like these can actually threaten their very future, as Summerson's comments about Fitzwilliam Street in Dublin often did. Now, I know that we are taking, I've chosen particularly pejorative statements by Sir John here, and it is true that there must be a role for criticism for the assigning of value in architectural history. Otherwise, how would our good friend Dr. Bradley do his job, and how would Historic England decide which buildings are Grade 1, Grade 2 star, Grade 2, or don't quite make it at all, unfortunately? What? And I absolutely acknowledge that there is a place for a critical analysis of historic buildings. The question is where to draw a rather difficult boundary. And I'm suggesting that Sir John is falling somewhere on the wrong side of it here. And it gets worse, of course, when Sir John arrives in the 19th century. Oh dear, oh dear. Can you believe this statement remained in print in the Pelican History of Art for 50 years? This, and I put some pictures up to just remind you just how feeble, deficient and poor the architecture of the 1830s was. I mean, there's Wharton Street. Sorry, I got the street wrong, Andrew. I do apologise. Wharton Street, but Lloyd Baker Estate. I mean, who'd want to live there, for heaven's sake? And Grey Street, Newcastle. Ah, Georgian Disneyland. I don't know. What a failure. I read those words and I do not know what he is talking about. And this seems to me the very the extreme point of this sort of personal aesthetic response to architecture when you can slate and dismiss an entire generation, an entire decade. Does this actually mean anything, and does it tell us anything? What about judgments like this for a not unpopular building? Well, this is all very perplexing because, of course, I'm being very unfair to Sir John here, and these extreme statements do not represent anything like the totality of his view. It is perhaps unfortunate that in 1970, Summerson published a collection of essays called Victorian Architecture, and in it he expressed his conviction that Victorian architecture had been a failure, repeating that word over and over again, as if the mere repetition somehow made it true. But this didn't represent the totality of his thoughts about Victorian architecture, as we know, because, weird as it may sound, he was also planning a different book about Victorian London, as successor to Georgian London, and as work towards it, he wrote a number of superb essays, like these two, which are wonderful analyses of their subjects and don't contain pejorative language at all. I don't quite understand it, I have to admit. And then there's the famous essay on William Butterfield or the Glory of Ugliness. Now, I certainly depart from Sir John in one important respect. I've never found Butterfield's work ugly, and I've always thought this one of the most beautiful buildings in England. But nevertheless, Summerson felt a deep sympathy with Butterfield, but this encapsulates both his fascination with the subject, but his inability to rid himself of his mid-20th century modernist critical eye. What is going on here? Well, we have to bear in mind Summerson's enigmatic character and his oppositional habit of mind, and here is how David Watkins summed it up in The Rise of Architectural History. His distinguished mind, ever questing and worrying, now found especially sympathetic those 19th century authors and architects who had expressed doubts about the merit of the architecture of their day. Thus, Summerson's Victorian architecture interprets the subject in terms of failure. And my goodness, how they failed for Sir John. Yes, horribly unsuccessful. Problem of failure, no point avoiding it. No point trying to find a name. As I've already suggested, a failure, 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 failure. I would suggest that what we are looking here is not history at all. This is rhetoric of a peculiarly interesting kind, that this represents a triumph of criticism of architectural rhetoric over historical realities. There was no consideration in this book, really, of the vast and complex realities of late Georgian and Victorian architecture. He bases his case that Victorian architecture was a failure entirely by appeal to previous writers who have judged it to be a failure. He says because lots of informed Victorians thought it was a failure, so it must be. Well, ever since the Enlightenment, and certainly since Logier, there has been this periodic tradition of oppositional critical writing about architecture, interpreting the architecture of its own age as a failure, often by reference to an idealized future. For Logier, everything since the Greeks had been rubbish. For Pugin, Gothic architecture was Christian and structurally honest, and contemporary architecture was dishonest and cosmetic and dreadful. Ruskin built on Puginian foundations, and in the 20th century, the generational rejection of Victorian architecture was immensely enhanced by the functionalist philosophy of the modernist generation. These generational rounds of criticism, comment, and rhetoric are indeed fascinating. They are part of the stuff of our subject, and this rhetorical critical culture is highly important in the development of architecture, but it is not the truth, and it certainly doesn't constitute sound historical method. Just because a few Victorian or modernist critics said that Victorian architecture was a failure does not make this the historical truth, any more than Logier's criticisms of Rococo culture or Pugin's criticism of late Georgian architectural culture are true. It seems as if there is a war within Summerson between the architectural critic and the historian. The historian, represented by the history of the King's works, by Georgian London, by those essays about Victorian culture. And the purely historical work is superb, but more often the critic wins. And this is one of the ways in which Summerson is enigmatic. He's both historian and critic, and when you approach a book, you can't quite know which character, which persona is going to win. And Summerson's views are really crystallised nowhere more than in his thoughts about preservation and about the idea that historic buildings should be preserved by law. For he was involved in the first committees which first set up the National Buildings Record and the National List. And Summerson set out his views on the idea of architectural preservation in an article for the Listener in 1941, reprinted in 1945, and it's in that volume called Heavenly Mansions, The Past in the Future. Summerson sets out extraordinarily stringent, restrictive criteria for preserving historic buildings, which might be summarised in one word, excellence. You look at these statements. In almost every town or large village, one or perhaps two houses which stand out. He doesn't believe in the concept of historic character. Do not try to preserve what you cannot preserve. Well, I'm sorry, Sir John, but lots of us do think that's exactly what we're trying to preserve. And I think we agree where general sentiments regarding historic association should not be allowed to be an obstruction. They are, as I've said, in any case, fugitive. There is, I think, an almost sadistic refusal to allow sentiment, historical association, or the character of an area to be a criteria for preservation. There is an insistence on excellence, as manifested, as you see, by this proposed design by Ludwig Mies van der Rohe. It is difficult to find a single occasion, indeed, when Summerson made a clear intervention or statement in support of the preservation of a specific building. He wrote a biography of John Nash, and in almost the same years, he distanced himself from efforts to save the last of Nash's Regent Street. He positively condemned Fitzwilliam Street in Dublin. He didn't intervene in the campaign to save Euston Station or St Pancras, and in his last public statement in the 1980s, as you all know, he intervened to support construction of this design by Mies van der Rohe in place of those Victorian buildings, which, as we know, all eventually came down. So his critical mindset had implications for conservation. And that, I think, is where we... Was Summerson a great historian? Well, yes, of course he was. The ambiguities and complexities themselves testify to that. His reimagining of English architectural history, his confident assigning of it to stylistic periods and categories, really has shaped the subject ever since. However, it can be argued that Summerson remained first and foremost an architectural critic, and only secondarily a historian. Yet Summerson himself, a complex and sophisticated man, was aware of this, and occasionally the Olympian self-confidence was dropped, as in his lecture, Art and Society. All my writing life, I've been haunted by a sense of guilt about writing about things which don't connect, which don't have some sort of lodgement in real life, writing about buildings as if only I and the building mattered, of failing to make the building seem an objective part of the scene in which emerged, in other words, relating it to society. This is a tribute to his self-knowledge and intelligence that he could articulate one of the most important objections to his own approach so clearly. The style-based architect-dominated view of history that Summerson helped bequeath to us has been a powerful intellectual tradition which embodies a vast deal of scholarship, and as a mode of looking at architecture it still has value, but arguably it is exhausted and has run out of road in terms of its potential for development and fresh thought. And as we've seen, there are already other ways and other strands of seeing buildings as made by society, for society, being developed by many distinguished scholars. But There's one other matter which, to my mind, is even more important than widening the scope and focus of architectural history, and that is the buildings themselves. And this contra Summerson is to recognise historic buildings as a precious, finite resource whose value goes far beyond those rare qualities of artistic excellence which, in Summerson's view, alone justified preservation, and support, or at any rate, not forget, the efforts made by owners and planners and consultants and others to preserve them. His judgment in the case of Fitzwilliam Street shows how little he would have sought to preserve. And if you applied such standards to an average English town, what would be left? And this carelessness, this casualness with the very stuff of our architectural history, our very subject matter, represents the worst of his legacy and the one aspect of it which deserves not revision but rejection. Summerson's view showed no understanding of historic buildings as a finite and threatened resource, and no understanding of the speed with which that resource would be eroded without legal protection. Here are some tiresome statistics. We have about 25 million homes, of which about 374,000 may be listed. About 2% of building stock is listed. Remember, that represents our whole architectural history, about 2% of building stock. Over 200,000 net new houses are added to the existing stock. At this rate, even allowing for a lot of the new homes being apartments, the entire stock of listed houses would be replicated, so to speak, in 2 or 3 years and replicated again in another 2 or 3 years. So much for the claim advanced by Summerson and others ad nauseam that the preservation of historic buildings holds back development. Without extensive legal protection for historic buildings, this pressure to develop and convulsive change in society and patterns of shopping and economic life would doom whole tracts of buildings to destruction. High streets, churches, municipal buildings are safe because they are listed. Our listing system, with its relatively broad criteria of selection, contra Summerson, enjoys very widespread support and has become a central part of our planning system for very good reasons. Summerson's ultra-selective approach to conservation is long out of date and would have doomed whole historic town centres to destruction. Summerson was a critic and a historian, and often a critic first, and his critical legacy has helped shape our understanding of our subject. And I'm not saying for one moment that the role of architectural critic is not valuable. Its value to society and its importance in shaping architectural culture has been demonstrated again and again. And looking at this kind of thing, you might well think that our own age is sorely in need of more of it, and that the lack of passion and the lack of oppositional critical voices is one of the things that is most sorely wrong with contemporary architectural culture. Yes, I wonder what Summerson, the herbivore modernist, would have made of all this. A while back, I read Charles Moore's biography of Margaret Thatcher, and in the preface, he wrote this. When I interviewed her, she could never quite understand that historical inquiry is not the same as political combat. And I'm saying that historical inquiry is not the same as architectural criticism, and architectural criticism is not the same as historical inquiry, and the two are, to an extent, incompatible with each other. Deploying a critic's approach to historic buildings, as Summerson so often did, is often ahistorical, imposing a contemporary aesthetic viewpoint on the past. And it can be positively anti-historical in its effect, undermining real sympathy, obscuring and diverting attention from complex historical truths, and sapping the reader's will to understand things better. It can lead to absurdities, like Summerson's blanket condemnation of the whole of Victorian architecture as a failure, and at its worst, as in the case of Summerson's unhappy intervention in the Fitzwilliam Street saga, this style of criticism makes a mockery of local pride, ignores and derides the value which communities place on their historic buildings, and undermine the efforts of those who seek to preserve them. The freedom to criticise, of course, is sacrosanct, but the critics cannot themselves be immune from criticism. So, in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, society needs both critics and curators in its architectural culture, but our historic buildings, if they are to survive, need curatorial values of understanding, sympathy, and care. Historic buildings need curators more than they need critics. Thank you very much. Someone's going to disagree. So I find absolute unanimity rather troubling.
Here we are, Simon.
Hi, Simon.
Stephen, thank you for that. That was a marvellous presentation of the 17th century, amongst other things. I feel a bit of a pang for the term artisan mannerism, and not only because Pevsner adopted it and therefore it became part of the shorthand, essentially, language of the buildings of England. But I wonder, I mean, if you were to show a progression of church monuments with all of their architectural language throughout the 17th century, perhaps that might stand up rather better. And perhaps if one, as it were, thinks outwards from the frontispiece type of design, then there's still a case for dear old artisan mannerism somewhere.
Oh, what a nice thought. It would be nice to resurrect it somewhere, wouldn't it? My objection is the degree to which it has diverted attention, I think, from the fundamentals. And obviously my contention was that what happens to English domestic architecture in the 17th century is fascinating, but our perception of it has been diverted by a concentration on style. And it hadn't occurred to me that actually if you translated artisan mannerism to the realm of the sculptural, that actually it still has a role to play, which is a lovely idea, because once someone, because it's, well, they're nice sounding words, and it would be nice to redeploy them there. Thank you, absolutely. Yes. God. Yes.
So you talk about sort of economics and practical changes leading on the aesthetic changes of the 17th century architecture. What would you say has led to the changes that we see now in architecture and the, well,
you mean that kind of thing?
Yeah.
The rule of the property developer and of certain kinds of accountants' formulae, and of the QS and the accountant and the project manager and the astronomic land values and all sorts of other rather unhelpful considerations, which mean property developers always just want to get as much square meterage as they possibly can onto any given site, and it becomes a sort of game between them and the planners and the terms in which the local plan is framed, doesn't it? And the slightly humiliating way in which great cities are obliged to go slathering after billionaire investors, which I don't suppose is going to get any better anytime soon, is it? I'm not a competent commentator on contemporary architecture, and I put this in to make a cheap point. But I'm afraid that I think there are other people in the audience who would be better able to explain to you why, despite the fact that we have a modern architectural profession which is full of intelligent, public-spirited people who really try their best, our architecture still comes out again and again looking like this. It's all rather difficult. But the thing I find most troubling is that actually there are so few coherent oppositional voices. I think we need another Ruskin, don't we?
Mm. Hello, I'm going to be a bit cheeky and ask, what would architectural history after Brindle look like? So, once this has sailed through numerous editions, what changes would you like to have achieved through this work, and what might be some of the barriers, perhaps, to that change being enacted?
I'm trying to present buildings as being made by society for society. Of course, it's a completely ridiculous brief to set yourself. But it means that the approach has to be thematic. So there has to be chats about towns, and there has to be one about roads, and there has to be one about landscapes. But I also, I'm trying to present architecture as a cultural narrative too, and in terms of the way in which architecture was translated from being a craft-based tradition, whereby architecture was largely comprised somewhere between the heads, eyes, and hands of craftsmen, and in craft skill in 1530, and by the end of our actually rather well-chosen period, had been translated entirely to paper and had become a vast paper-based realm, which is not just about translating all the craftsmen's bodies of knowledge to paper and the whole language of design to paper, but there are all sorts of source books about architectural history which sort of generate new architecture and which allow the clients to be involved, and there are books like Thomas Hope's book and all those books about J.C. Loudon, all those villa designs, and architecture has become part of wider consumer culture, and having been entirely translated to paper, and the craftsmen having lost all agency, shall we say, have to do what they're told, and the degree to which architecture by 1830 has actually become a subject in the kind of sense which we're discussing now, which I certainly don't think it was in 1530 or 1630, or it was only just starting to be in 1730. So I'm interested in, I'm suggesting ways in three rather pathetically short chapters of seeing architectural culture, an evolving architectural culture, as being one of the motors, one of the things which drives architecture, I think, rather more fundamentally than architectural style. I think there would be, you'd lose that if one just concentrated on the material, and so I've introduced these separate chapters. Now, I don't think I've done them at all well, because they're very short, and there's too much, and there's more than I can read. So what I would hope is that other people will do that kind of thing, in particular write about architecture as a culture, as a developing culture, part of wider culture, more intelligently when they see how badly I've done it. When they see how badly I've done it. Alan.
Thank you. You did pick out Summerson's worst moments.
I did, didn't I? Yes. This was rather a polemic.
Get an example of where his words do help us to see something positively.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Go back to the picture of Coleshill. Massive, serene, and thoughtful. Coleshill was a statement of the utmost value to English architecture. It's a beautiful line. And if I was a fundamentally nicer person, I would probably put it in with a picture of Coleshill. Sorry, Alan. Yes. No, and he writes beautifully.
I'm not really trying to rescue Summerson here.
I was rather hoping you were.
I'm trying to rescue us.
I think that's probably a better idea.
And not just us in this room and what we do, but the architects out there as well. Because for a strange combination of reasons, it strikes me that the discussion of what things look like and the attempt to evaluate them in any way at all has now gone for three generations. There used to be a time when it was taken for granted. People might have done it badly, but it was what people did. And then we policed ourselves, and so did the architects, and they are not taught in any sense that one thing might be better than another. And I teach in architectural schools, even the good ones don't do this. And the historians don't do it. And none of us know how to do it anymore.
I think you're suggesting that in dethroning architectural criticism, I'm potentially doing architectural culture a colossal disservice.
No, I mean, you're coming very late in the day.
Yes, I
because
am.
The damage has already been done for a very
it
long
has.
Time.
Yeah.
But the remedy, I don't think, is to go back to Summerson, but it is in some way to rebuild a culture of criticism which is aware
yeah.
of the pitfalls.
Mm. I couldn't agree more. I mean, I think that those rhetorical oppositional voices in architectural culture have been, you know, Logier and Pugin and Ruskin are so important in shaping architectural culture and making people at the time see things differently. The reason that I find it troubling in Summerson's case, and I find it potentially troubling in architectural history, is that we now... I think have to conceive ourselves as curators in relation to what we've inherited in a more active and protective way. I mean, they weren't really worried if, you know, all their medieval buildings gone, which is why most English towns have very few medieval buildings left. And we have to worry about this rather more. I think what I'm suggesting there is that architectural history needs tiptoe around historic buildings, but I think you should go for it with these things. Good Lord, yes.
Well, you mentioned... people who do listing, and it has struck me for a very long time, having been quite close to that process, that certainly some of the things that I can value and see in a building are not seen.
Yes, I can...
And almost anything that can be objectified scores, anything that is subjective doesn't really exist.
I think I know what you mean. And this applies in particular to 20th century architecture, where we are still rather feeling our way in assessing what we've got and where it's actually going rather quickly.
Well, the criteria I'm aware of are being the first of something, being the influential example of something, being the good example doesn't count. If it's the second or third one, and it's really much better than the first one, it still doesn't count. I say better because that's what I think I know.
Oh, I see. Well, not really having engaged with the preservation of 20th century buildings, I didn't know that, Alan. I'm kind of, and it's an insight which I had not shared, so thank you. I think what you're saying is that architectural criticism actually has a job to do in shaping and assessing our inheritance before it all disappears in perhaps a rather more active way than I may be allowing, and certainly where the 20th century end of it is concerned.
Mm. Thank you.
Oh, good.
Not that I'm someone who's ever been used star labels, and I'm a great proponent of vernacular classicism. So there are lots of things I would say. Taking his oeuvre as a whole, he certainly was very concerned with the relationship between architecture and society, and that quote in that lecture is a typical one where he's arguing... saying something against himself, which he's fully aware that he has done through his career. And we only have to look at George in London, which is posited around taste and wealth, to see that. So my point back to you would be architecture is about taste and wealth. Hmm. So, you know, architecture in Britain may not have so much about the wealth, but through the rest of his career, those two are circling around the whole way. And I think a lot of that comes out of the same things you're talking about, that he had to compress a great deal. He's writing this history for the first time. Pevsner as well is a German idealist, and the buildings of England is full of denigration of Palladian architecture. So Palladian architecture is Pevsner's bugbear, Victorian architecture is Summerson's bugbear. So I think, I mean, Artisan Mannerism, you can read it back the other way and say... that it's innovative in that time for him to be considering these buildings, which are not by named architects, and putting them in this grand narrative. And in later editions, he does actually drop the term and changes it. And of course, in later editions, he adds chapters like Men and Materials, which go some way towards what you're talking about.
Yes.
Of course, his Men and Materials are a sort of 1970s view there, Industrial Revolution onwards, so it's late 18th century onwards. It's not materiality in the early modern period in the way we'd look at it now. But he, you know, it's absolutely the case that he is fully aware of the change in historiography between the 50s and the 70s and through to the 80s. And ditto with Victorian architecture. You know, his view changes, and by the end of his life, he's despite the Mansion House Square inquiry, he is writing favourably about it and acknowledges that he was just of his time in, you know, ghastly Gower Street view. So I think you've made me want to go back and look at architecture in Britain in isolation. and is it the one that is the exception that proves the rule? So I'd be arguing architecture in Britain is the exception that proves the rule. The rest of his work is all about architecture and society. Can I just say one more thing on preservation? Sorry, I'm going on a bit. So one more thing on preservation. Again, you can argue it the other way. He did a lot as deputy director of the MBR for cataloguing buildings through the war. He then manages to get, at a time when everyone's thinking about new build, he manages to get listing and preservation into the process officially. That's an amazing achievement. You know, it was certainly not top of the list. Yes, he has a different view from current day. That's not surprising. And he was on what we would probably now see as the wrong side of all those major ones. But he was also on the Historic Buildings Commission from the beginning. He was on the GLC Historic Buildings. If you go through the curator's diary at the same as I have, 40 years of curator's diaries, he is going out to look at cases for a good 30 years. He's off all over the country, going to public inquiries, standing up for historic buildings. So he did a lot of under-the-radar preservation work. It's a bit, therefore, there is a contradiction. When he's above the radar, he's generally arguing the opposite. But he did an absolutely enormous amount with the Georgian group, with SPAB, all sorts of people. So a huge amount of his working life was actually taken up with casework of historic buildings. Anyway, we will continue this discussion later, but that's I want to put the counter view.
Thank you so much. Well, I think this is sort of half turning this way now. So I think that's the formal part of the evening finished. So through that door, there are things, and we can continue our conversation formally. And I'd just like to thank Stephen one more time for a wonderful talk. Thank you so much.